It's Mr. Welch with another Welcome to Mystara, and this week you've picked the topic that I've been dreading for a while, trying to incorporate the Red Curse into 5th edition. This week is going to be crunchier than usual because it's a rules conversion topic. It wasn't easy. 5th edition likes things nice and tight with its bounded accuracy and its resource economy, and Red Steel was all about rolling on a random chart to see what superpower you get and hope your eyes don't pop out on stalks. It's time to pound a square peg into a round hole and hopefully come out with something pretty. The one thing I'm not going to do on this video is convert all the powers from Red Steel to 5th edition. There's 80 unique powers in the book, and you'd zone out if I tried to convert all of them. In that way lies madness. But there's more to the Red Curse than just the powers. You've also got the mutations and the stat loss, and 5th edition despises stat loss. Unlike the drainers from the days of old that dock your stats, these don't even hit double digits in 5th edition. But for the Red Curse, that's the whole point of the curse. For a refresher course, the Red Curse is a nasty three-part curse that is found in the far western part of the continent of Brune called the Savage Coast. Without going into the long and complicated history of why there's even a curse in the first place, I'll just say the curse affects everyone that lives there, and if you visit for too long, you'll be cursed as well. The only way to lift the curse is to leave the area and find a powerful cleric to cast Remove Curse. However, if you return, you'll be cursed all over again. Permanently cleaning the area of the Red Curse is a campaign-level event. The curse is a three-part process. First, you roll to see which ability you'll get. There's four different regions in the Curse Lands, each with their own chart. Roll a d20, and whatever ability it says you get, that's what you get. This part can be done in 5th edition without changing anything. So you roll a 14 in Region 1, you get the Senses ability, where in Region 3 the same roll gets you the Leap ability. This coincides with the color effect of the curse, where everyone living in the Savage Coast has their hair and skin tinted red. That's a purely cosmetic change, so no conversion there. One effect the reddening does have is mechanical, so that any creature touched by the curse reads as magical. If you cast Detect Curse on somebody with a legacy, that creature glows along with everything they're wearing. It makes Detect Magic almost useless in the cursed lands. Now for the nasty stuff. When you first develop your legacy, you get what is called the Time of Grace. You roll a d4 and add 5. That's how many days you have where your newly acquired legacy works with no drawbacks. That's only once per day, or in 5e terms, once per long rest, but you aren't in danger of your stats draining away or mutating out of control. After the Time of Grace is over, that begins the Time of Loss. This is the dangerous part. Your legacy manifests fully. You can now use your legacy 3 times per day, or 3 times per long rest, and one of your stats goes down, depending on which legacy you rolled. The Time of Loss lasts 2d4 days. Each of those days, the stat dictated by your legacy drops a further point. If a stat hits 0, you're dead. You mutate to death. In Red Coast, Charisma just left you hideously deformed, but 5th edition doesn't do Charisma the same as 2nd edition, so just use the 0 equals dead for Charisma as well. It's simpler. After the Time of Loss begins the Time of Change, which takes d6 plus 4 days. That's when you mutate. All mutations are related to your legacy. Every legacy tells you exactly how you're going to mutate. The 360-degree vision, for example, manifests as eye stalks, while the flight ability causes leathery wings to sprout out of your back and so on. These aren't X-Men mutations. They are quite painful at all times. I don't think the pain is enough for a mechanical effect, but it's something to remind the players on occasion if they somehow acquire a mutation. The mutations are cosmetic. They don't affect the legacy's working at all. To avoid the worst of the mutations and the stat drain, you need Cinnabryl, a mineral found only in the Savage Coast. You wear an amulet of Cinnabryl during the Time of Grace, and you negate almost all of the bad stuff. You still get the legacy, but you lose a point from the affected stat, but that's it. You won't mutate or drain to death, but there's no way of getting that lost point back. The problem is, Cinnabryl is used up when it's used as protection, and you need to replace it every so many weeks or else the drain and mutations start back up. If you ever run out of Cinnabryl, the Time of Loss starts up again and lasts the maximum 8 days, so don't run out of Cinnabryl. Getting Cinnabryl after you've lost points will recover these points slowly, but it won't reverse the mutations. If you ever go through the full Time of Loss from having the mutations start up again, you'll need a Remove Curse spell to be able to use Cinnabryl again to reverse the drain, which is recovered at a rate of 1 per day after a week of waiting for it to take effect. After that's fully recovered, except for, of course, the 1-point loss, then you have another Remove Curse spell cast, and that will remove the mutation. That can be done in 5th edition easily enough, even though it's quite painful. The main point is that the stat drain can never be reversed easily. 5th edition is fairly pillow-fisted in lasting effects, but that goes against everything Red Steel is. It's tough love time. Go with the Red Steel penalties, because that's the point of the setting. Now for the tough part, the legacies. Second edition was much more complicated than fifth edition. Legacies have three uses per day, which translates into three per long rest in fifth edition. Most of the abilities can be recreated with spells. Charm works exactly like charm person. Breathe water is water breathing. Anti-missile becomes protection from normal missiles. Those are easy enough. For saving throws, use the ability score suggestions. For the ones that allow saving throws, which isn't many because most of them require a roll to hit, go with the spell equivalent. Casting power is the standard 8 plus proficiency plus relevant stat bonus. Some of them you're going to have to work on a bit to make fit because they don't have a 5th edition equivalent. Fight or shoot gives you a Thaco of a fighter of the same level. Of course, Thaco is gone, and fighters don't get a better chance to hit than any other class at the same level now, so you just have to give the character advantage for a minute on all melee or missile attacks, depending on which one you're using. The proficiency legacy lets you gain, well, proficiency in a skill or a toolset that you don't have for a particular period of time. Second edition, the time limit was normally based on your level, but for fifth edition, it's going to have a set time period, normally in minutes. Rounds in 2nd edition were a full minute each, meaning a single minute in 5th edition is greatly reduced in power. That's something to consider when determining the length of the abilities. The Find ability, for example, works for a number of minutes twice your level, and works like Find Object for a single item. A single minute isn't long enough often for this one. You're going to have to figure out more reasonable times. Remember that people have taken a penalty for these powers, so don't skimp on the length of the power. The powers are determined at random, and they are nowhere equal in power. Protection from normal missiles is a third-level spell. Magic weapon is a first-level spell. Both are possible from the chart that you're rolling on. Some of the legacies are almost cantrip in power, though they're not very strong, so you need to upgrade them a bit, like light. You can use light to try to blind people for a round, I guess. There's also disintegrate on that list, though it doesn't work on living creatures, but it's still pretty powerful. But that's the charm or the curse of Red Steel. There's a lot of randomness built into the system intentionally. Fifth edition doesn't have a lot of randomness in creating your character. A lot of people prefer the cookie cutter characters that stat buy and stat array devolve into, instead of rolling dice for actual character creation, and many people even cringe at the thought of 3d6 straight down, which of course is the only true and pure way of creating your character. Then you have the issue of the inheritors. This is a big issue because I couldn't find a way to make them fit easily in 5th edition because 2nd edition kits and 5th edition backgrounds are similar, but backgrounds don't have mechanical bonuses while kits do. Inheritors are characters that have gained the ability to gain multiple legacies. In 2nd edition, it was a kit that worked with all classes. Turning into a background requires a little work, but there's a formula to work with, so take two skills. In this case, I'd say medicine and arcana. Then get the inheritor ability that every time your character gains a stat increase or a feat, they can also qualify for a new legacy if they can get the Crimson Essence that normally just gives temporary legacies. To balance, you do have to include the penalty from 2nd edition in that guns mess up inheritors badly. Guns are an inherent part of the Red Steel setting. One of the nations is based around them, so you do have to include guns if you're going to be playing in the Red Steel. If a gun is fired within 2 feet of an inheritor, or make it 5 feet, because 5th edition is all about the 5-foot squares. If a gun is fired within 5 feet, it burns an entire week of Cinnabryl from the inheritor's amulet. Most amulets last a week per ounce, so if a prolonged fight breaks out and there's a lot of shooting involved that's really close, that's going to burn off a lot of Cinnabryl. The nastiest part of this is the effect is retroactive. If the gun depletes all of the Cinnabryl that the inheritor has, the next shot causes the inheritor to go into a full week, into the week of change. So that's -7 to the associated stat. The next shot is going to cause another -1, and then it's going to start causing mutations. It's nice having multiple legacies until the gunslinger with 3 attacks just walks up next to you and shoots into the air 3 times. So those are some tips on running the Red Curse in 5th edition. Turning everything into a spell effect would probably be considered a cop-out, but there's 80 abilities and most of them just copy spells. The curse is punitive and that can kill you, but that's what curses do. 5th edition is death light, 2nd edition isn't. It's a major source of the rules conflict with the conversion. There's little balance when disintegrate and light are both random options on the same chart. There's no semblance of fairness. But Red Steel had the reputation for being one of the wildest and most memorable D&D settings in a game known for its weirdness. I'll get the poll up next week soon. This week has been tough because I've got a massive amount of scheduling issues. The book has been pushed back another 2 weeks because of a formatting issue that we just now finally got fixed. It was an easy fix, but it was time-consuming, and it required the book to be completely reprinted again. So, the 17th time's a charm. So until next week, don't Cronenberg up the world.